Hi and welcome back down to the basement. It's Dan here once again, and I have got a real special machine for you to look at today. From EBS, based in Sweden, we have not just the EBS HD360 model, which has been on the market for a little while, but actually this is the 30th anniversary limited edition version, which actually its specifications are a little bit different from the current HD360. In fact, it's more like the original HD350, the predecessor model. Now, they are subtly different and they both sound absolutely brilliant, but I know that people who are used to hearing the 350 kind of really like the characteristics that it brings to the game. So we're going to run through, as usual, we're going to go through the front panel and have a little listen to what each of the controls do. And we'll have a little listen to this absolutely awesome EBS NeoLine 210 cabinet underneath it as well in just a moment. But let's take a look at the amp first. Okay then, so usual fare for us. And certainly when we've covered EBS gear before, they like to keep things nice and clear for us. They're not going to go and change things around and confuse things. So left hand side, as usual, here is our input socket. But no, this is no normal input socket, because what they have done with the HD and the TD models, I think also the Fafner, the big machine as well, not only have we got an input for your instrument, but this is also a phantom power output. Now, unfortunately, I can't demonstrate this. It's not something that you're going to hear. But if you're using an EBS pedal or, for example, an active bass or something like that, you can actually power it from the amplifier and not actually have to put any batteries in your pedals, which I think is an absolutely wicked idea. And there's a switch to switch on and off this phantom power mode. So an EBS pedal such as the Billy Sheehan drive pedal or something like that, you know, you could power it from the amp. Leave your wall wart power supply at home. How handy is that? Moving on, we have the EBS character pre-shape control. Now, in previous reviews, I've always called this the kind of the big cab sound. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to fast forward a bit and turn off the equalizer section on this amplifier so we can hear the difference that this character switch makes. So this is the sound of my bass with no equalization or anything. This is a nice flat sound. When I enable the character switch, it boosts the lows, it boosts the high frequencies, and there's a dip in the mid-range. This is going to be ideal for a lot of percussive kind of techniques, but certainly, even with fingerstyle, it really fattens things up. Let's hear it with a bit of slap style. And it sounds really, really great when you've got a smaller size speaker cabinet as well. It helps to kind of fill in the low end. In some ways, it's a little bit like, you know, the old loudness control that you'd get on some really nice hi-fi gear. Okay, I'm going to switch that out and I'm going to go back to our EQ system on the amplifier itself so we can move along. Gain control here, standard fare. We want to set up our input level and there is a little peak LED next to it. So when I slam the bass, I'm getting that little light there flashing away. But when I play normally, it's not flickering away too much at all. So I set up my gain to get a really strong signal into my amplifier without overdriving. So a little pink, that peak LED is flashing when things are getting a bit too hot for the input section. Next to that, compressor. Absolutely brilliant for us bass players. So if you're switching between techniques, you're hammering away with your thumb, playing some slap, and then you want to go and play something more kind of up the top of the neck, nice and smooth with finger style, the compressor is going to get hold of those peaks and then just smooth them out a little bit. So I've set this up at around the 9 o'clock point on the dial here, just so it kicks in when I dig in a little bit. So if I play normally, so I'm just trying to play a little bit on the ragged side to see if I can get that compressor light just to flash every now and then. Or if I play slap style, you can see the compressor, the threshold is now being sort of met and the compressor is starting to limit my signal. I can go crazy and I can boost it all the way around and literally everything I play is going to be really squashed. You can hear the compressor really hanging on to every single note and I get an almost sort of bowed kind of quality. It's great as an effect, but it's also brilliant just to keep your level under control. Okay, let's move on. We have an active equalizer system here with bass, middle, treble, and bright here. And as mentioned before, we have a switch that we can actually bypass it. So you can either have an ability to compare your sound by bypassing the EQ, or you could even set this up for a very particular sound. Maybe if you wanted something which was a bit more percussive for slap bass tones, then you could enable the EQ for doing that kind of style of music. Bass control is a fixed frequency, the treble and the bright also, but in the middle we've actually got a semi-parametric EQ. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to buzz through each of the knobs so you can hear the differences that it makes when I boost and cut those. And then we're going to talk about the parametric separately. So here's the bass control. What I'm going to do is I'm going to dial it down to zero. Bit of finger style. Boost it out. I've gone around to 3 o'clock and I can already hear the cabinet is going, it's going crazy. There's a lot of boost available. Tons and tons of boost. So I'll go easy on that one. I think in my intro, I was probably more like the kind of like 1:30, 2 o'clock kind of setting on the dial. Going the other way, 9 o'clock setting, here we go. You can tell already there's a lot of weight gone from my sound. So once again, there is a lot of boost, there is a lot of cut available on that control. So unless you are on a really boomy stage, I don't envisage that you're gonna go that far with cutting the low end. You're going to lose a lot of weight from your instrument tone. A That sounds really, really nice with this particular instrument. It's got a nice fatness to the low end without being too boomy. Indeed, actually, one of the differences between the 350 and the 360 is the center frequency for the bass control. I know on the 360, it's actually set a lot lower. So this one, I would say in comparison, would be more punchy. And I would say the 360 has probably got a bit more low end bloom to it. I kind of like this one. It's gonna be great for slap style, that real sort of kick drum type punch around the 100 hertz region. Yeah, really nice. Okay, whilst we're talking about fixed frequency equalizers, treble and bright. So the treble control, I would say, is great for plectrum attack. So for example, if I wanted a bit more bite to my sound, this is where I'm going with the dial. I'm gonna push that out a little bit. And if I start pulling that treble away, my pick attack is gonna be a lot softer. And that is exactly where I want my treble control. I want to be able to dial in a nice little bit of bite if I'm playing something maybe a bit more rock. But also, if I'm playing with a pick, I can actually dial it out and it sounds a little bit more like finger style. Maybe I should demonstrate that. This is dialed out with the plectrum. And if I push the treble back around again and go finger style, yes, I can hear a bit more clarity in there, but there's no kind of like bite when I'm using the pick when I've dialed that treble back. So a very, very, very nice touch on there. Bright control, this is more in kind of the sort of airy frequencies. So if you are somebody, a fiend who likes those brand new strings, a bit like I like to, then the bright control is gonna certainly bring out the zing. So if I play some harmonics, bright control. So even playing very gently, you can hear that lovely shimmer of top end. But if that's not your thing and you want to almost dial out what the tweeter's doing on the cabinet, back the other way. I can see this being really, really useful. I mean, this is an active bass and it has a very hi-fi kind of tone to it. Dialed it right out. My bass no longer sounds like an active bass. Very nice indeed. Excellent. Going back to our mid-range control then, I want to talk about this in some more detail. We have the same kind of gain control for boosting and cutting our mid-frequency portion of our sound. But we have a dial here that allows us to choose exactly which frequency we are going to dial in and dial out. Now, this might take a bit of getting used to over a normal boost and cut control because I can use it in two different ways. I might need to target that I'm missing something in my sound. Maybe I need some low mid-range. Okay, well, let's go for 200 hertz and I'm gonna dial that in. Let's have a little listen. So that's zeroed, and if I boost it back out again, I've got a nice bit of warmth to my tone. But I could actually use it the other way and think, well, actually, my sound has got too much of something. Maybe this bass being active, it's a bit too twangy. So I can go around the other way and I'm gonna go up to a high frequency and I can start cutting that out instead. Let's have a little listen to that. I'm gonna slap style it. Thank you. boost it out just so I can hear the difference. So it's a really, really useful effect. And I know that some people just use it as a boost, but it's nice to be able to cut away things as well. I liked it on this particular cabinet to add in some low mids, so I boosted around the just below 200 Hertz region. And that in conjunction with the bass control as well gave me a nice big fat sound. Speaking of fat sound, on the 360 we have a drive control. Now this is not, I would say, a usual drive control that you'd find on maybe a distortion pedal. This is more of a power amp drive, just to warm up the signal a little bit. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to set this up. I need to just adjust the master volume because as I bring the drive up, the whole level comes up. So let's just do that. Okay, here we go. Now that setting is very, very subtle, but I can hear in the studio here a nice little bit of grit going on, but it's not a top-end grit, it's a nice mid-range warmth. Let's push it a bit further and see what happens. Kind of in Jack Bruce territory now, that kind of like slightly filthy sounding Marshall amp is really starting to flap a little bit. Whether or not that's a sound I'd particularly use all the time, I guess it depends on what kind of band you're going to be playing in, but it's nice to know that I can go there if I want. I sort of liked it dialed back around that 12 o'clock setting where I was just adding a bit of extra excitement to my sound. Okay, let's dial that back. Okay, there we go. Now, across the front panel, rather than having any sort of important connections around the back of the amplifier, the EBS has a DI output. EBS have put it on the front of the amplifier rather than around the back, so if you've got this amplifier in a rack case, then it's going to be easy for your stage engineer or recording engineer to get to. Very handy indeed. Thank you very much, EBS. Along with the output, we have three small switches here. The first one on the left-hand side, I have enabled already. This is allowing me to send absolutely everything about my tone controls and settings out to my DI, which is being recorded here today. That could also be your on-stage sound going out to the PA, etc., etc. But by disabling that switch, then I just get the sound of the bass and it bypasses all of this. Very, very handy if you were maybe recording and you wanted to reamp later. I've got a nice clean sound which hasn't been touched by any drive settings or anything like that. Speaking of recording, next switch along, we have a speaker simulator. So at the moment, I'm sending my sound with the EQ straight out to the DI and then to be recorded for this review. But if I was playing on stage, what it might be, I can actually punch in a simulation of a speaker sound, and that is on this middle switch. Should I encounter any buzzes or strange noises or anything like that on stage, maybe with bad earths or anything like that, there is also a ground lift on here. This isn't a guaranteed fix for buzzes and things like that, but certainly you're going to find this commonplace on a lot of bass amplifiers to help try and alleviate any strange noises. Now that's it for the front panel, other than the very, very cool graphics I might add. around the front. But around the back of the amplifier, we have yet more connections. We have an effects loop, so we could plug in any other sound devices such as outboard effects, might they be compressors, equalizers, or maybe an outboard such as chorus or something like that. There is a tuner out, so if you're running a separate tuner, this will allow you to tune with the master volume turned down, and you won't have to unplug your bass or anything like that. And there's also a line out, which is great for, again, running to recording devices, or maybe you're slaving into another amplifier for extra power. The whole amplifier is inside a good solid metal case. This thing is made for the road. It's not one of these little plastic toy amplifiers. And as I said earlier on, it actually has fixings here to go into a rack case to make sure that you can protect your investment. The whole thing, we're not in D-class territory here, so this amplifier isn't designed to be super light. We're weighing in actually at only 9 kilos. So even though it is a big amp, it isn't a really heavy one, so it's not going to kill your back carrying it around. Now, let's move on. Underneath, we have the EBS NeoLine 210 cabinet. You have been hearing it throughout the review. This is from the EBS lightweight range. And what's really interesting, reading up about the specification about this cabinet, is I really like that EBS has taken the idea that the speakers will go specifically with cabinets. So, for example, you wouldn't find exactly the same speaker in a different configuration cabinet. They've chosen it specifically to get a sound. I really like that. It's a great idea. Speaking of which, as I mentioned, two 10-inch speakers. And the whole cabinet weighs in at 19 kilos. So these are neodymium speakers, so they are efficient and very light. They will take 500 watts, and that's 102 decibels sensitivity. So you can see on the dial here, my volume control is reasonably low, and I'm still getting a lot of volume from it. Specs-wise, the cabinet is a 4-ohm cabinet, but 8 ohms is available. So that's a fairly recent addition, I believe. Correct me if I'm wrong. So it's really, really great that you can now pair up multiples of these cabinets and still not go below your minimum rating of your amplifier. The whole thing is covered in this rather nice sort of carpeting with some nice plastic corners. Underneath that, we have a birch baffle. So a nice, good, stiff baffle for the speakers to be mounted to, but the actual shell, rather than going with the heavier wood, is a light spruce wood. So that means the whole weight of the cabinet is kept down, and EBS are doing their best to maintain a good, solid sound. We have, behind the microphone here, we have a 2-inch tweeter, and there's lots of wonderful brightness. One of the things I like about EBS gear is this ability to be bright and hi-fi. Think Marcus Miller, for example, who had been using EBS for quite a long while. Should that be too bright, though, around the back, we have actually got a tweeter attenuator, so it can turn down the brightness, or it can turn it up, which is very, very handy if you need more brightness. And then around the back on that same panel, we also have speak-on connectors to pair with the amplifier as well. So there we go, we are rounding up. I hope you've enjoyed hearing the amplifier and through some of its various settings. I really like it. It's got a nice big organic tone, but it can also do hi-fi as well. So there we have it. This is the EBS HD360. This is the 30th anniversary model. And underneath that, the EBS NeoLine 210. I'll put some more information in the written review, and I will catch up with you again soon.